This is the last section of material. We're going to talk about abnormal psychology. Abnormal psychology is also known as psychopathology. We're talking about the issues that people have with living. And we'll find out that it's not them, it's us. We all have difficulties at times. Sometimes our difficulties are overwhelming, and sometimes we muddle through them. Sometimes people are aware of our suffering, and sometimes we suffer in silence and nobody knows what we go through. And some of us struggle more than others. Some of us have more difficult life circumstances than others. Others of us have fairly simplified or easy, seemingly easy life circumstances. But being a millionaire does not guarantee you a life of happiness. As they say, money will not buy happiness. As David Lee Roth says, it'll buy you a yacht big enough to pull right up next to happiness. But it won't make you happy. It won't make you satisfied. I'm going to use a lot of terminology on these slides where I'll use shorthand, which I've already suggested to most of you, that you learn how to create your own shorthand in each class to facilitate note-taking. But when you see these particular terms come up, you'll know what they mean. History, HX, history. Diagnosis or disorder, usually, DO. TX, treatment or therapy. SX, symptoms. PT, patient or CLT, client. RX or meds, drugs, prescriptions, medications. BEH, behavior, and the little triangle there means change. Change in a positive direction or a negative direction, depending on a lot of factors, change is a possibility. See you, man. Absolutely. What is abnormality? What is it to be abnormal? Is it bad to be abnormal? Is it wrong to be abnormal? Is there something fundamentally unsound about abnormality? Well, abnormality can be thought of in a lot of different ways. As we'll see, some people get paid a lot of money to be abnormal, to be unusual, to be not what the norm is. The norm is your average. It's a statistical concept in some ways. So what are we looking at? One way we look at abnormality is deviation from the norms. Deviation from the norm, and now we're talking about a normal distribution. Right? When we talk about personality characteristics of personality disorders, it's not like people with personality disorders have entirely unique and unseen, unheard of personalities. They just tend to be more extreme on some traits than others, less flexible than others. Statistically, it's outside the norm for personality characteristics, right? You look at intelligence, we've already talked about that. Intelligence not being a value that we should measure human beings worth by, but just an ability to work with information mentally. One could be very high on that ability or very low on that ability, but most people are in the middle. They might lean one way or they might lean the other way. But when you go far afield of the mean, then you are abnormal because you are outside the normal curve, right? That is a statistical concept. Sometimes that can be not advantageous or detrimental to a person to be far outside the norm. Other times we celebrate it, right? Artistic people, do you want your artistic people to do what all of us do? Or do you want them to be different than the rest of us, right? We celebrate their art because it's not what you see and do every day. Right? Athletics. Do you want a team full of average players? Right? People get really upset when their teams don't do well. They want all their players to be above average, don't they? Right? You can't all be above average by definition, but you can recruit people into certain subsets of populations that have advantageous abilities that allow them to do stuff. Religious leaders, leadership context. Do you want any normal person to be a president, or do you want somebody who's highly qualified to do that in an abnormal way? Somebody that's willing to dedicate or give most of their life away in the service of other people, right? We want people who are our leaders to have different kinds of qualities, not normality, so to speak, but abnormality in a way that we hope is positive. We also have leaders that are abnormal in other ways that aren't so positive sometimes, right? And that makes a problem for us as a society, but it's interesting. Society has accepted standards. We call them norms. I don't think that some people are crazy and other people aren't crazy. As I told you a long time ago, I start with the premise that we're all crazy, right? To some degree. We're not all evil, and we're certainly not all psychotic. But we all have eccentricities, we all have proclivities, we all have hang-ups and issues that we deal with as individuals that we don't show to everybody, but we suffer with or struggle with within ourselves. We all have these things. So to me, it's not, are you crazy? It's how crazy are you? Are you aware of your own issues? And if you are aware of your own issues, are you willing to do anything about them? Because for the most part, people are open to change. At least the humanistic view is, you can change. You can make a better life for yourself. You can go through your struggles and come out a better person for having gone through them, right? So in this sense, in society, money counts. So if you're rich, really rich, Howard Hughes was really rich. They didn't send him to a mental institution. They called him eccentric. So if you're really rich, you're eccentric. If you're poor, you're crazy, right? That's a big difference in society. How people are treated is a function of their affluence or power, because all of us are affected by being human. But having more power or more money oftentimes allows people to have more leeway with what society will tolerate from them. Leeway depends on the person, the individual circumstances, et cetera, et cetera. Suffering and distress. All people suffer. So how is that a criteria? We all suffer to some degree at some points in our lives, right? Even living a perfect life, which, what is that anyway, right? But let's say we're materially comfortable, we're reasonably secure, right? We don't fear for our lives. We feel pretty confident that tomorrow's going to come and we'll be all right. We'll eat, we'll have a home, our family will be around, and we lose people that we love, right? That's a part of living. It's a hard part of living, and we will suffer as a result because we care. To not care is another kind of suffering, right? But most people care, whether they show it or not. And so when we're talking about suffering and determining abnormality within the context of mental health, we're talking about what's not usual. Suffering to a more extreme degree or for a longer length of period in such a way that it causes difficulties for the person that they themselves would rather not have to deal with. They would like to feel less suffering, less emotional pain. And that is perfectly legitimate. It's not even noticeably present in some disorders. People who are manic or psychotic may not realize that they are psychotic, right? They may not realize in their mania that they're engaging in dangerous and risky behaviors. They may not be aware of it. So they're not suffering. They feel, in some cases, great. In some cases, suffering's quite clear in psychosis. People are frightened. They're terrified. They're very, very upset. But in other cases, when there's grandiosity of a positive nature, they think great things about themselves contrary to reality, they feel pretty good. We talked about intellectual assessment. And what used to be called mental retardation is now called intellectual disability. But I know a lot of people who fit those categories, meaning it's harder for them to live in this world because it's harder for them to understand concepts we take as basic to survival, like being able to read or compute mathematics, like paying bills, holding jobs, and things of that nature. But they're perfectly happy people. All right, so they're not suffering, but they might need help to live an independent or supervised life. So suffering and distress is individually relative to you. How much are you suffering? How much distress do you feel? Or does it cause dysfunction? So I might be perfectly happy in the sense that I don't feel upset or I don't feel emotional pain or turmoil. But if I have, let's say, a test score, an intellectual assessment of about 60, 65, and I don't really know how to read, and I can't hold certain jobs because I'm not qualified to hold them, and I don't really understand how the bills get paid or the taxes get done, that's not going to allow me to live a perfectly independent life. The functioning that I'm able to achieve is going to be impaired by some degree, from marginal to severe, depending on the issue. Right? So it's not that the person's suffering or in distress, but they need help functioning. For other people, intellect is fine, but the issues that they suffer from cause dysfunction. For example, schizophrenia. People maintained on medication without psychotic episodes are more or less like the rest of us. But if they deteriorate into psychosis, whether or not they feel that as a suffering experience, it certainly interferes with their ability to interact with others and to hold jobs and to function in ways that make it possible for them to live independently at those times. Being treated, they might return to that function. But other people from less dramatic kinds of issues as schizophrenia or bipolar 1, where you have this really rapid and severe shift from consciousness, from reality-based to not necessarily reality-based, and sometimes completely non-reality-based experiences, things like anxiety can be debilitating. You think about if you have a work presentation you need to give and you have performance anxiety and getting up in front of people just terrifies you and you have the equivalent of a panic attack while you're supposed to do that, you might not be able to do it well. You might not get a raise as a result of that inability at that time. Depression can become so bad for people that otherwise would function normally. They're suffering and they're feeling distress and can articulate it as such, but they don't want to get out of bed necessarily, right? So they might miss work a day or two. And then having missed work a day or two, not wanting to explain that to others, it might make it really hard to go back. And having these kinds of issues interfere with one's life, school, relationships, right? Work, various facets of our lives can be affected negatively by the states of existence we might find ourselves in at any given time in our life. Note that some companies are motivated to sell you things. I'm not anti-drug, don't get me wrong. I'm not anti-medication, don't get me wrong. Some people hear what I say and they draw that conclusion. I say be very careful about your diagnosis to make sure it's accurate. And then try, if available, and that's oftentimes the issue, talk therapy because there's no side effects to it. It tends to be effective, as I'll show you, because you should say, are you sure it's effective? Yes, I am. Science shows us it can be effective, as effective as medications. And there's less relapse. But if I have somebody that's suicidal, literally suicidal, you think I'm going to say, well, I'll try talk therapy first. No. Let's get medicated. Let's get everything we can to bring it to bear on the case. Some people would prefer to use medication first because therapy requires time and intensive effort over time to achieve results. And sometimes the medications will help you through the symptoms, which is what you're suffering from anyway. And isn't that what you're after in some cases, is relief from suffering? And if that works, then that is awesome and should not be shortchanged. But in some cases, you will find that these are the only options offered to people who are suffering is medications. And sometimes they're misdiagnosed and given medications that are not really appropriate, because the misdiagnosis leads to mistreatment. And that's something you got to be very careful of. We won't go that deep into diagnosis when we go through this material because this is an introductory class, but be mindful. When I went and sat in a waiting room at a facility that I know people working at, I just saw a little electronic device on the table. I picked it up and it had a series of questions with three answers. Never, sometimes, often, or something to that effect. And it would ask me things like, do you ever feel fidgety? Sometimes I feel fidgety, right? Do you ever have problems with concentration? Sometimes I have problems with concentration. These answers are going to hardly ever be never because I'm a human being. And after a series of these questions answering sometimes, I was then given a summary statement at the end that says, you might have ADHD and you might want to talk to your doctor about medication. Well, guess who manufactured the device and whose name was on the device? The manufacturers of the medication that they were suggesting I might want to talk to my physician to take. But if I wasn't educated on these things, right, if I didn't already know the criteria for ADHD and know that I don't meet criteria for ADHD, I might be worried. I might be concerned and I might go to my doctor, who will hopefully go through a much more rigorous process than that. But having heard certain symptoms and the patient maybe being convinced that they have an issue, might be inclined to make a diagnosis pretty quickly and prescribe medications without supplemental treatment that might either correct the diagnosis or provide other alternatives.